What does it mean to glorify God in and through our suffering? Let's talk about it. You are good and you are kind. You bring joy into my life. You make it easy to trust you. Happy midweek, everybody. Welcome back to another edition of Midweek here on Facebook Live and our website. Yeah, we're on our website, exchangeokc.org. Welcome back once again. It's good to be with you again. I've got a nice cup of hipster coffee here with me tonight as we read the Bible and have some coffee. That's usually what I do. All right, so you can grab a cup of coffee if you want. It is 5:30 though, so be aware of that. But tonight I'm excited because we're going to be talking about just a few verses of the book of Romans, chapter 5. And tonight we're going to have somebody else introduce us to this scripture. But give it just one moment and we'll get to that point. I do want to make note right now that as of right now, we are still aiming for May 31st as our return to church day, all right? So right now, that's our plan. We will have worship service only on Sunday morning, May 31st, and we will go from there. We're hoping to begin Sunday school once again, Sunday school on Wednesday nights once again in June. That's our goal, but for now, we're saying May 31st, our return to church as we seek to worship together in person on Sunday, May 31st. And I personally am excited about that. I can't wait to see some of you once again. It's going to be great. But let's plan for May 31st. If anything changes on that end, stay tuned to our Facebook page. Stay tuned to our Students at Exchange Instagram. And we will let you know as soon as we have an update or any sort of information regarding our return to church plans. So without further ado, I'm going to send it over to a good friend of ours to introduce us to tonight's passage of scripture.
Therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight by faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ our Lord has done for us. Because of our faith, Christ has brought us into this place of undeserved privilege where we now stand, and we confidently and joyfully look forward to sharing God's glory. We can rejoice too whenever we run into problems and trials, for we know that they help us develop endurance, and endurance develops strength of character, and character strengthens our confident hope of salvation. And this hope will not lead to disappointment, for we know how dearly God loves us, because he has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with his love.
Thanks, Grace, for introducing us to tonight's word from the book of Romans. If you don't mind, I would like to start us off by praying. So if you would, wherever you are, would you join me in prayer? Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we are thankful for the words in which you have spoken to us through your holy word. And I pray that tonight, as we look at this passage from Paul, that we would know to glorify you in and through every bit of suffering we may face, knowing that our hope is not found in anything here on this earth. It's not found in riches or anything like that. It is found in you and you alone. And I thank you for that truth. And I pray that we would recognize that as we look at your word tonight. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So as you heard read just a moment ago, we're going to be in Romans chapter 5. We're going to look at just five verses tonight. So it's a big difference from what we did last week. Last week we were looking at like 25 verses in chapter 4, right? But tonight we're going to be looking at just five verses here at the beginning of chapter 5. So continuing into Romans chapter 5, one of the biggest themes that we've seen is that we're justified. We are saved by grace through faith in Christ Jesus. And therefore, that's how Paul starts off chapter 5. Therefore, because we are justified, because we have salvation in Jesus, therefore, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And there is such richness in just that text there in the first couple of words. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. What does it mean to be at peace with God? Because we get that. We get that, as Paul says, through salvation, we have this peace in Christ Jesus. So I kind of narrowed it down a little bit just to kind of give us a better idea of what we're looking at, what we're dealing with. I narrowed it down to just asking myself this question, all right? Are you, and you might have heard this in a movie before, you might have heard it even in scripture, but are you at peace with God? Are you at peace with God? A true, genuine peace with God? Are you at that point in your life? And I think that's an important question for all of us, because if we receive that peace, if we receive that peace through salvation, then it's going to be important for us to be able to answer that question, don't you think? Rather than thinking about it in like the sense of a dramatic point of your favorite movie where somebody might be knowing that they're about to go into battle and something's going to happen in battle to them, or something crazy in a movie is going to happen where they need to make their peace with God before they meet their action-packed climactic scene of the movie, right? But in reality, I think the real question that we need to be asking, are we at peace in our salvation with Christ Jesus? There are many people that I know that I've come into contact with over the last couple of years just in ministry that they might think that they are saved, but when they actually think on the moment they called upon the name of Jesus, or when they think on their lives after that moment, they realize they were never really at peace with their salvation, and they were never actually saved. Now, we believe that as Christians, as believers, that once you are saved, that salvation cannot be taken from you. However, it is possible that many of us wander around. We go to church on Sunday mornings, and we maybe we go to Bible study throughout the week. Maybe we even make our Tuesday morning prayer meeting, but we're never truly at peace with our salvation. We're never truly having that peace of God that surpasses all understanding, because you're never actually truly saved. But since, Paul says, therefore, since we have been justified by faith through grace, which means therefore, because we are saved, we can be at peace with God. How beautiful is that? That we can be at peace with God in that circumstance. Let's continue. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. So we have peace in Christ Jesus, but we receive this unending grace that comes straight from Christ Jesus. We are living in grace. We are living in God's beautiful, unyielding grace. And what does that mean exactly? You think maybe when you were having school in person, right? Maybe when you were having school in person, you had a situation where you made a 42 on a math test, like I sometimes felt like I would run into in high school. Make a 42 on a math test, but yet your teacher gives you an A. That is grace, even though you did terrible on your test. But you get an A anyway. You're given grace. Maybe those of you who are older and you have to make payments, there's grace periods on payments in life sometimes, right? Not always. Sometimes we wish there were more on other payments than others. But sometimes there is grace when talking about these things. There's grace when it comes to certain aspects of life. But more than all of those things, there is grace that comes straight from Christ Jesus. And because we are saved by grace through faith, we now receive this grace, and it is never ending. how great it is we have access by faith to this grace in which we now stand. We gain access to that faith through salvation in Him. Verse 3, let's keep going. And this is where this passage kind of shifts, right? So Paul's writing and he's reminding us that because we are saved, we receive peace, we receive grace. But now when we look into verse 3, the tone changes and we begin to see a grip full of suffering. So thinking through this, and reading through this, let's pick back up here in verse 3. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings. We glory in our sufferings. Because we know that suffering produces perseverance, character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Right? So not only do we have access to peace, do we have access to grace in Christ Jesus, but we glory in our sufferings. You see that that's used as a verb, right? We actually glory in our sufferings, meaning we exalt Christ Jesus in our sufferings. We praise Him in our sufferings. In James, it says, count it pure joy when you face trials of many kinds, right? Count it pure joy. Now, I'm not saying, and I want to be very clear about this, don't dumb this scripture down too much. Don't dumb it down too much to just be happy during your sufferings constantly, right? Because that's going to be hard. That's going to be really hard. There's a difference between suffering simply with a smile on your face, just happy, joyful. People are going to be a little freaked out because you're a little too happy that you're suffering, right? There's a difference between that and actually glorying in your suffering, exalting Christ in your suffering. That joy happens because you can praise God. You can praise God in your sufferings. He says, not only so, but we glory in our sufferings because we know that suffering produces perseverance. So normally, right, we don't always rejoice in something because there's not always good that comes out of it. Usually, if we are upset about something, or we're fearful of something, or we know that something isn't quite so great, if we're suffering, we don't like it because suffering brings something negative, right? It brings something bad, not so good. If a friend or a family member gets really sick and they're suffering, we almost grieve that because we know something bad is coming for them. Yet, we rejoice, not because they are suffering, but because of what that suffering produces. Perseverance, and perseverance character, and character hope. Ultimately, through that suffering that it talks about there at the beginning of verse 3, through that suffering, there is hope. There wouldn't be reason to rejoice if there was no hope, right? But through that suffering, you go from verse 3 to verse 5, where it leads us down a path of hope. And hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. So this hope doesn't put us to shame, but it actually energizes us, helps us be able to rejoice in our sufferings. Helps us be able to glorify God even when things stink. And we got to keep in mind as we look through this that Paul, who's the person writing all of this, Paul also suffered. He's not coming from a position where he hasn't suffered, right? He suffered. He wrote prison epistles. He wrote letters to the churches from prison, right? That's part of suffering. He's glorying God. He's glorying in his sufferings, glorifying God in his sufferings. In 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9, it says, and this is also writing from Paul, it says, "But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you." He says, my grace is sufficient. And then he says, "For my power is made perfect in weakness." Another reason that we rejoice in trials, we rejoice, we glorify God in sufferings, is because one of the things that comes out of that suffering is that his power is made perfect. We are reminded that God is made perfect in that. And Paul writes, "Therefore, because God's power is made perfect, therefore I will boast all the more gladly about my weakness." His weakness meaning his trials, his sufferings, his tribulations, things he's going through. He will boast all the more gladly about his weaknesses so that Christ's power may rest on him. What a passage of scripture. And what a passage there in Romans chapter 5. God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us. All these biblical qualities, perseverance, character, leading us down this path of hope. So I want us to think about this tonight. We have this cool logo for our student ministry, or at least I and like two other people think it's cool, that puts our little badge that you see behind me. It puts it in line with 2020. So like we do a slightly different logo for each year, right? So it puts it in line with 2020. And I kind of feel bad for making a logo for the year 2020, because I feel like up to this point, many of us, and at times including myself, are thinking, man, 2020 really stinks, right? Lockdowns, quarantines, viruses. But we can still rejoice in that. And this reminds me of the simple truth here out of Romans chapter 5, that suffering produces perseverance and character produces hope. Going down that line, suffering produces hope. We don't just think on hope, meditate on hope in our suffering. That suffering actually produces hope. It produces hope. So instead of looking at all of these things as though they are just these terrible things that we should mourn, or these terrible things that we should feel bad about, we can actually see hope being produced through this. One thing that keeps coming to mind here, and I'll end with this tonight, is truly glorifying God in our sufferings, knowing that that suffering is going to produce hope. There are so many people that you and I probably both know, specifically it seems like in the year 2020, that are going through some of the toughest trials they've ever faced in their life. Whether it be health, whether you know somebody who has contracted the coronavirus, or whatever that trial may be. Maybe it's unemployment. Maybe it's students. Maybe it's your parents dealing with financial difficulties in the midst of this thing. The economy, whatever it is, all these trials. It feels like for a lot of people, this has been one of the toughest few months of their life. How many people do you know that can actually say they can glory in their sufferings, as this translation says, or rejoice or exalt Christ Jesus in their sufferings? How many people do you know that can say that? We can say it out loud in a phrase and we can read it in the Bible, but it's not actually going to happen if that person isn't saved. It's not actually going to happen if he or she that you're thinking of knows Christ Jesus. Many people that I've talked to that are going through circumstances like this, difficult sufferings and turbulent, difficult times, they always ask, or they always mention, that they don't know how people do it without Christ Jesus. And that rings so true to me. As in many times like this, true hope, a hope that is found only in Christ Jesus, it can actually be produced from suffering. That's a blessing of God. That is a blessing of God that we, as his children, as believers in Christ Jesus, that can resonate with us. So as we close tonight, I just want to encourage you again that the gospel is for all. But even on top of that, because the gospel is for all, there is hope in suffering for all. Don't bottle that up here. Don't bottle all of that hope in you. Let some of it out, right? Let some of that out and share the hope that you have in Christ Jesus with people who right now might not be able to say they have hope in him. Wherever you are tonight, I ask that you would pray with me. Father God, we are grateful for the hope that is found in you. Praise be to God for simply the fact that we have hope, and through suffering, hope can be produced, and we can glorify you in and through our hearts in our suffering, even when things stink, God. We are thankful that we have that ability. We are thankful for the peace that you give us. We are thankful for the grace in which we now stand, because we stand redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Lord, we thank you and we praise you this night. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you've missed any of our midweek sessions for this series, I invite you to go to exchangeokc.org, and you can find them all online in list format there at our church at home page for our student ministry. Students, let's have a good week. Go share the gospel with somebody through FaceTime, through text, whatever you need to do. Go share the gospel with somebody this week. Love you guys. Have a wonderful rest of your week. You are by my side. I'll follow you.